Good morning. Welcome this morning, and thanks for your patience. With added technology comes added technical difficulties. But we are good to go. Our live stream's up, and we're ready to worship. So let's stand together and sing some songs.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Thank you that we can meet here together. We thank you that you meet us here. God, above all, we want to commune with you here this morning. We know and we trust that your Spirit is here. We know that you are with us because your word promises it. And so we praise you. We lift you up. God, I pray that our worship is pleasing to you. I pray that it glorifies you alone. And we give it all to you this morning. Amen. This is number 95, if you'd like to use your hymnal.
Trust in you. With all I am, I live to see your kingdom come. And in my heart, I pray you'd let your will be done. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home. I'll trust in you. I will live to love you. I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in all of you. You are the voice that called to be. You are the the whisper in my heart that speaks to me. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home, I'll trust in you. Child in all of you, I will live to love you, I will live to bring you praise, I will live a child in amazing takes me home, I'll trust in you.
This is from John chapter 16. I've said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and have come into the world, and now I'm leaving the world and going to the Father. His disciples said, "Ah, now you are speaking plainly and not using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God." Jesus answered them, "Do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming, indeed it has come, when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world."
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence.
Be seated, and Eric has a children's story for us this morning.
Anybody coming up? Anybody coming up? Here we go. Once I get this microphone untangled. Wow, this is great.
We're going to talk about number three. What are some things that come in groups of three? Anything? Anybody think of anything that comes in number three? Twinkies usually come in a package of three. Three-leaf clovers, shamrocks have three. I'm going to ask you a different question then, related to this three. Can we see God? Can we feel him? Can we hear him? But we can see the effects of God. We can look out in nature and see his creation and his works. We can see what God's people do. We can hear other people talk about God, right? Feeling him, that's a tough one, isn't it? We can feel his love when we give love and share love. So, have you heard of the word Trinity before? Anybody hear the word Trinity? Who knows what the Trinity is? Camille? Okay, we're going to break that into three parts, and I'm going to repeat what she said. I'm going to use the piano. I've got to move these glasses out of the way. So we have God the Father, and I'm going to play a note. You can hear that, right? I'll play it again. So it's one note, like God the Father. Then we have, what was the second part, Camille? God the Son. I'm going to play another note. Different note, different sound. And the third part was God the Spirit. I'm going to play another note. Completely different sound. Now listen what happens when I play all three together at the same time. I'll play it again. All three parts played at the same time become one sound together. And that's a way that we can hear God and get an understanding that even though we can't see him, we can't feel him, sometimes we can hear him. We get that little voice saying, hey, maybe we shouldn't do this. Why don't you do this? Help someone out today. Someone's hurting. We can show his love. And we're going to pray. I want to read this verse from 2 Corinthians 13, verse 14. May grace of Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. So we'll pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your creation and all that you have given us. Help us to take notice to the things you have in store for us. We love you and pray for this week to come. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you go out to the lobby, Kylie and Elizabeth Schrock are going to be out there for Children's Church. Thank you.
It's a pleasure for me today to introduce for Ministry Focus Lisa Doyle, the new director of, is that what you call it, director? New director of Love, Inc., Love in the Name of Christ. We have a long-standing history with Love in the Name of Christ, good things that have been happening for a long time, and lots of people from our own congregation involved. And Lisa's the new director, and I just want her to present the ministry to you.
All right, thank you. It is such a pleasure to be here, to be able to worship with you today. My church is not yet open for worship, so this is very special today. And I understand that some of you serve here. Elaine is here. Wave, Elaine. And Ruth is here. And in the back is my right-hand woman, Jolie. So just to share some information about Love in the Name of Christ, we serve in a 3-county area. We are in all of Union, Snyder, and the upper part of Northumberland counties. And we are here to help mobilize you, to meet your neighbors, to serve them, and to see lives transformed. And we do all of that, of course, in the name of Christ. Golden rule, Love in the Name of Christ, has, like the pastor said, a long-standing relationship with your church. And I just want to take the opportunity to thank you for being a partnering church. So when people call the church for help, a lot of questions arise. And it can be tough to take the time to evaluate each of those questions. Who do you help? How can you help? Is it legitimate? And Love Inc. helps with this process. Love Inc. handles the intake process and matches the request for help with those who are able to serve. We have the time to listen to the person and hear what their needs really are. We don't just look at the presenting need, but consider overall, how can we help the family? For example, somebody calls and says they need food. We don't just take them to the food bank. We get to have a conversation with them on the way. We get to find out, do they have a community church that they're worshiping at? Are they familiar with the love of Jesus? And we get to consider their emotional and spiritual needs as well. Like any good project or building, we need a good foundation. And for years, Love Inc. has had the wonderful foundation of the clearinghouse, people calling in for needs. We're looking more into gap ministries and also transformational ministries at this time. So when we get calls from clients, we don't make any assumptions about them. We don't decide who has money and who doesn't have money. We don't ask clients for funds. They may give if they wish. We don't presume to know their family situation. As I said, some families have a good faith and a good Christian background. Others aren't at all interested for now. But we will serve them in the love of Christ and pray that our deeds done in love will move them closer to God. So I want to share a story with you. I'll call her Roberta. That's not her real name. One of our office volunteers took Roberta to the store, and whenever they got home, she offered to pray with her. And Roberta was open to this. And then a day or two later, Roberta called into the office. She asked Cindy if she had some time to talk. And of course, that's what we're here for, right? And so Roberta got to share with Cindy how angry she had been with God. She moved to a new area, and now she has cancer, and she doesn't understand why God is allowing all of this to happen. But she shared with Cindy that the night prior, she had prayed, and she told God that she wanted to turn in her anger and trust in God. And she told Cindy that was a direct result of the love that she had seen from the volunteers from her church and from Love Inc. So you might be asking yourself, how can I help? Or if you're not, I'm here to ask you, how can you help? Do you have ears? Can you just listen to somebody when they share their heart? Do you have a phone? I'm sure your phone doesn't look like that, but we have care and concern ministry. There are people at home, especially due to COVID concerns, and they would love to just talk to somebody on the phone. Will you make calls for the ministry? Do you drive? Are you willing to give somebody a ride to Walmart or maybe to a doctor's appointment? Are you good at fixing things? Do you enjoy yard work? So I have shared Roberta's story and Cindy's story, but each of you also have a story. So feel free, please, after the service, to share your story with me. And you can give me your name and number if you're interested in volunteering or have additional questions about the ministry. And if you're watching from home, please feel free to Google us, Golden Rule Love, Inc. Thank you.
Before you go down, I just want to pray with you for a minute. I mean, just anybody in the room that has ever worked with, worked for, served, volunteered, directly given to Love, Inc., can I ask you to just raise your hand? Because I know we have a lot of people.
Wow, thank you.
And so if when you involve yourself with Love, Inc., you're participating in a tradition that this church has had for a long time and deeply, deeply woven into our fabric. Let's pray together. Dear God, I thank you for Love, Inc. I thank you for the way that they reach out with your care and your love to the community. We thank you that they have the ability and the capacity to do some things that we can't directly do, but we do thank you for the ability to reach out to them and to refer people to them, the opportunity to serve through them. We thank you for each individual who's working with Love, Inc. now that's among us, and we thank you for Lisa and the work that she does too. We just pray, dear God, that you would uphold them with your power, that you would strengthen them with the resources that they need, that they would receive volunteers, that the folks who call them for help would see in the things that are done for them the love of Jesus and be able to participate fully in the invitation that you have extended to all people to come to you. In Jesus' name.
Sky to close the day, await the surf where dolphins play, the taste of salt, the dance of waves, and my soul wells up with hallelujahs. A lightning flash, my pounding heart, a breaching whale, shooting star, give testimony that you are, and my soul wells up with hallelujahs. Oh, praise him, all his mighty works. There is no language where you can't be heard. Your song goes out to all. Cratered moon and sparrow's wings, O thunder's womb and Saturn's rings, unveil the Father as you sing, and my soul wells up with hallelujahs. Oh, praise him, all his mighty works. There is no language where you heard. Your song goes out to all the earth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The pulse of life within my wrist, a fallen snow, a rising mist. There is no higher praise than this, and my soul wells up, oh, my soul wells up, yes, my soul wells up with hallelujahs. Oh, praise Him, all His mighty works. There is no language where you can be heard. His song goes out to all the earth. Hallelujah, 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 oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
I've been looking forward to today. Gregg Brubaker is a friend of mine. We've known each other a good long time, although we didn't get to see each other that much, because the whole time we knew each other, he was in Lithuania. And that's not, you know, doesn't make for a nice, tight, close friendship in most regards. But Gregg is a great guy, and he and his wife and their children have been friends of our family for a long, long time. When Gregg was in Lithuania, he taught, computer and math, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, computer and math at Lithuania Christian College. And while I knew him, he came to our church and spoke, and he brought this message that is just so profound. And I wanted to make sure that you got to hear it. So I've been looking forward to this for a long time. Gregg, thank you for coming. Let's pray together. Dear God, please be with Gregg. I pray that you'd be with him and with his family. I thank you for them, and I thank you for what they have done in your name. I pray that you would continue to bring blessings from all the work that they've engaged in over the years and continue to engage in with others and with their own family. I just pray that you would strengthen the work that they've done and give it ongoing blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.
I would first like to say that I'm enjoying your worship service this morning. I hope it continues. but you have a very nice worship service this morning. I'm sure every Saturday morning. Like to thank the worship team and the tech guys that I gave a little bit of a headache to this morning, but they figured all the glitches out, which is good. And thanks to Pastor Tim and Don, too, for singing. The pastor doesn't often get thanked from the pulpit, so I'll give you a chance. I was asked if I could share a little bit about our COVID experience. Yes, my wife and I had the COVID virus, and our boys were obviously exposed to it, although like most teenagers and young kids, if they had it, they were asymptomatic. You could never get them tested because they didn't show any symptoms. Well, Sharon's and my experience started out like it was the regular cold. Runny nose, coughing, a little more coughing than normal kind of thing. And the way it was going, we figured, well, we probably had the mild form of it. We did test positive for it. And, oh, in case you're worried, they don't consider me contagious ever since July 16th. So it's well past a month. I'm not going to spread it to you. Then the one of the things that we noticed was that it made us also feel tired. It was just like the flu. It wasn't really a big deal. I wasn't worried about it. Some of that also depends on where you're putting your trust. People worry about, oh, what if I get COVID? What if I get the severe, the very strong case? And you start to get your eyes off of God. One of the things that I found is every now and then, especially once we got the COVID moved into our lungs, and then we had some respiratory problems, which bumped us up to the moderate level of COVID. What if? But realistically, it's, well, what if I get hit by a car? You know, what if I lose my job? You know, it's all these what ifs that we have to keep our eyes on God for, and they start to fade away. If you trust in God for your health before COVID, why can't we trust Him with our health now? One of the things that's a little bit different is the time it took to recover was extended. I don't usually take 2 to 3 weeks to stop feeling tired from getting a cold or flu, but I did this time. The respiratory thing, my wife went to a specialist. She had a little stronger than I did. And he says, well, most of the people are experiencing a 1 to 2 month time until they start to feel that they're back to about 80% of their normal self. So it just takes longer. We had the unfortunate thing of our area just came out of quarantine in the beginning to mid June, and then we got COVID in the beginning of July. So it was like we were in quarantine since March, it felt like. I'm an introvert, and so it wasn't as bad. But it's just what you do. You put up with it, and you live life whatever form you have it in, and you live to God's glory. So it's nothing to fear. Yes, there are people that die, but realize that may still be part of God's plan. I'm not going to say definitely is. I'm not going to say it's definitely not. But God is still Lord over all. Now, speaking of being Lord over all, when we look at nature, we oftentimes think we can see God through nature. I forget the name of the person doing the children's story. He's very true. When you want to see God, sometimes it's easier to look to nature to see. Now I'm running into a problem. Do I need to turn this back on, maybe? I need some help back there. I'm trying to advance it and nothing's happening. Well, that worked. It just doesn't want to go forward. Maybe you just have to manually advance it. I don't know if I hit something wrong in the, if you want to check the remote. Psalms 19, from verses 1 through 3. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. That's what we were talking about with the kids. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Nature is multilingual. Everyone can see it, and it points us to God. The heavens declare the glory of God. If we can go to the next slide. Maybe I can let you, in case I goof something up here when I put it in my pocket. On the first day of creation, can anybody help me? What did God create on the first day of creation? You can just holler it out, or if you want to raise your hand, it's okay. It's a little hard to hear, but God created the heavens and the earth. Go ahead and advance it. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And we think about this as stars, galaxies, our universe, our solar system, the earth. Well, one of the things we often don't think about as well is that probably God created time at that point, too. It's when things started. Now, the Bible doesn't say that, so I'm not going to say that's when time was created, but it kind of makes sense. Now, I know there's always contention between creationism, intelligent design, and science, and there doesn't always have to be. In fact, if we look at science, they basically agree with Scripture to this point on the order of things. Maybe not the timing of it, but the order of things. Now, the other thing, light. I do believe that God created light, obviously, as part of that, even though it's not listed. Is it just I'm too far away? Well, if we can advance the slide. Maybe that's the problem. I'm not aiming it right. It doesn't like me. That's okay. So let's just advance the slide. If we could advance the slide. Lots of problems. If you want to stop it and restart, that's fine. But on the second day, oh, this gets tougher. What did God create? Anybody remember? I have to say it kind of loud. Well, one of the things it talks about is that God separated the lower water and the higher water to create sky. And there we go. If we can, one more when it comes. That God created sky. Well, isn't that atmosphere? So God created our atmosphere, the sky, and so on, on the second day. So there we go. We got the sky. See if I can work here. Hey, it works. Thank you. Then on the third day, God created the land and the water. So there's water all over the earth, and he made the land come up. And with that, vegetation. And so far, science, as far as the time order of things, agrees. On the fourth day, now I never ask anybody what the fourth day is because this one's hard. Because it took things that already existed and created something new, and we don't think of it that way. God created the sun to rule the day, and the day and night kind of thing, and it also says then that turns into seasons. So God created these things, but we don't often remember these because it's like, oh, that's just kind of a result of day and night and that kind of thing. And science doesn't directly address this at all. The also says he created the moon to rule the night. On the fifth day, God created the fish. Here's one point where science says, well, science says we think that the fish were created first and then the land vegetation came after that. But that's the only difference so far. And that actually is something that changed 5 to 10 years ago. They had been, the order of it was pretty much the same. Now with that, oh, I forgot to say with the seasons, realistically, God's creating order and structure and consistency as he does this. And he also created the birds of the air. Now on the sixth day, most people remember that because that's when we get the animals. And I love the description about all the little creatures that scurry along the ground kind of thing. All the little insects and all that kind of stuff. And he created man. And that's, again, science order also supports this. Why do I keep mentioning that? I'm not trying to promote science or anything like that. Just trying to point out that most times we think of the differences between these three thoughts, but there's a whole lot that's in common that we kind of overlook. Now, on the seventh day, of course, God created rest. And science doesn't measure rest kind of thing, you know. It doesn't talk about that. Now, with all of this creation, since the beginning of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, they've been clearly seen, being understood from what's being made, so that men are without excuse. Think, well, eternal power, what is God's eternal power? How do you see that? Well, you could probably think of many things yourself, but lightning storms reveals God's power. Tornadoes, hurricanes for that matter, big things that we can see God's godlike power, and also volcanoes. Many of you are probably old enough to remember Mount St. Helens exploding and seeing some live footage of that. Immense power, blew the top of a mountain off. Well, God made that, and he has much more power than that. So we can see eternal qualities of God in nature. And the other thing it had talked about was his divine nature. Well, how do you see divine nature? Well, we oftentimes look at scenery and say, oh, that's peaceful. That's majestic. When I see a picture like this, and as you know, my pictures will not do justice to the real thing. It's just the way cameras are. But when I see sunlight breaking through clouds and these streams coming down, I think of God's majesty. And that's God, nature shows that to us. So a lot is revealed. And it's so that anyone can see, even the people that want to say there is no God, say, well, look at nature, and you can see God reflected in that. They just choose not to see it. Now, going smaller, can we see God's intelligence, God's majesty in small things too? Well, I'm going to suggest that yes, we can. In fact, we're going to use a little bit of math to see some of that. And don't panic if you don't like math or that's my worst subject. You know, don't worry, nothing gets hard. And hopefully you enjoy it anyway. But if you look at pine cones, we know what they are, of course. But when you look at these, can you notice some kind of spiral effect happening? If we took that one pine cone in the back and turned it this way so you could see the bottom, it would look a little something like this. That's a little tough to see, but can you see spirals? Now, they kind of maybe start and they stop, but they continue around. So it's a spiral in this case may look a little bit more like an arc kind of thing. But you can kind of see a spiral in this. How many people see a spiral that goes out and to the right? How many see a spiral that goes out and to the left? How many see both? If we look at a pine cone, we can see spirals both ways. We can see spirals going, what I want to say, clockwise. And, oh, the math part of it sneaks in here. There's 8 of them. If you look at this, 8 different spirals on it. And we can also see when it spirals to the left. And wow, there's 13. Different number, but it's what we see. Now, here's a computer-generated one that's a little smaller. And if we look at this one, we kind of see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And when we go the other way, again, we see 8. A slightly different numbers. The 8's the same between the two, but slightly different numbers. And can we see spirals in pine apples? Yeah, we do. So if we look at them one way, there's 5. Oh, it's interesting. Kind of like the pine cone. And there's 8 another way. Pineapples have a unique kind of thing where they have 3 spirals. You can see a third one going this way. 13. Wow, you know, that sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? Pine cones, 5 and 8. On a smaller one, the bigger one, 8 and 13. Pineapples, 5, 8, and 13. Wow, interesting. Well, let's go a little further. Where else can we see spirals in nature? Well, if you look at the center of a daisy, can you see spirals going to the left, to the right? Yes. We can see here, say, clockwise to the right and to the left. Now, these are a little harder to count. And they show both of them up on the same screen, so it's a little bit tough. But the scientists will say that on a typical daisy, you'll have 21 and 34 spirals. And so if we add that to our list, we see, well, there's no overlap there. I mean, they're different numbers and appears there. But let's look at something else. Let's look at sunflowers. They're bigger, right? Can you see spirals going left and right? Yeah. Now, the harder job of counting them. Well, I'm glad someone else did. And they did this. They say a typical one like this will have 34 and 55. Well, the 34 is familiar. But is this a big sunflower? There are bigger ones, right? And this one, if you can see the spirals, they count 55 and 89 on a typical one. But is this the biggest sunflower you've ever seen? No. Not that this is the biggest one, but it's big. And I would not be the guy assigned to have to count how many spirals there are in this. This is kind of intimidating. But if we look at it, we can kind of see, like over here, it's spiraling out to the left. And it's easier to see on the other side. It's like it's spiraling out to the right. The center is pretty hard to figure out. But someone did, thankfully, take the time to count. And a typical one will have 89 and 144. So if we add this to our list, Ah, now this is kind of interesting. The 34 overlaps with the daisy. The 55, you had a smaller sunflower with a higher number, is the same as the lower number of a medium size. And the same with the medium size large was 89. And the biggest one that I showed had 89 as the smallest count. Well, since we're doing some math with this, let's look at the numbers and eliminate all the duplicates. So we get 5, 8, 13, 21, 34, 55, 89, and 144. Now, moving it up and making it bigger so we can all see it clearly. Do you notice a relationship between these numbers? Is there any high schoolers here? Look around a little bit. Do you see a relationship between the 5, the 8, the 13, 21? And a couple of head nods. Well, for those who think about haven't had math for a while, what's 5 plus 8? 13. What's 8 plus 13? 21. What's 13 plus 21? 34. 21 and 34 is 55. 34 and 55 is 89, and 55 and 89 is 144. This is a pattern. We looked at patterns of spirals in nature, counted them, and there is order. There is a relationship in here. In fact, we could have fame and fortune if somebody didn't figure it out first, before us. A man by the name of Fibonacci, he was actually a contemporary of Leonardo da Vinci. That gives you an idea. Back in, was it the 1600s or 1500s? I forget. He started his sequence at 1, and said 1 and 1 is 2, 1 and 2 is 3, and he got this because of seeing things in nature. Realistically, for those that don't like math, that's how math started, trying to give order to things that we saw around us. And if we can take 89 and add 144 to get 233, can we add 155 and 233? Yeah, so this list could go on forever, theoretically, right? You keep adding the last two and make a new one. Now, where else might we see this? Well, there's lots of places, lots of different flowers, but it's not limited to just flowers. This is, if the lights were off, and you get real close to this, it kind of gets almost psychedelic kind of thing when you look at it on a bright screen. But it's just another flower that you can see the spirals in them. Now, if we're getting back to math, what if we did something with these numbers? We added, what if we divide? Well, if you take the second one and divide it by the first one, you get one. If you take the 2 and divide it by what comes before it, 1, you get 2. If you take the 3 and divide it by 2, you get 1.5. So if you keep doing this, take a Fibonacci, divide it by the one in front of it, before it, 1.666. 8 divided by 5 is 1.6. And if we continue the list, it looks like it's getting close to one number. Now, the number actually keeps, decimal keeps going, it doesn't stop. I just kind of rounded once it got to the third decimal place. But we kind of look at it and say, well, if this is 1, then it's 2, 1.5, 1.666, 1.6, 1.625, 1.615. Do you get this feeling for up and down and get smaller and smaller? Yeah, if we graph it, you see 1, 2, 1.5, 1.666. We get this up and down shape, right, as it goes. Well, it seems to flatten out. It does. Does it still continue to go up and down but real small? Yes. If I increase the scale, magnify this, that those numbers are going up and down. So if I took the last 7 and increased them in scale, they would again be going up and down. But it does seem to be approaching a number. Low to high to low. The low's not as low as the one before it. The high is not as high as the high that came before it. So it seems like all of the highs are coming down towards a number, and all of the lows are heading up towards a number. What is that number? Well, it's referred to as the golden ratio. And again, it's like pi for those that like math. The decimal continues forever. But if we round it to three decimal places, 1.618. And we see this from nature. Now, if you were looking, since you are looking at this, look at these four rectangles. It says triangle. I always forget to change it. Every time I do this, someone says, that's not a triangle, that's a rectangle. Yeah, you're right. Then I forget to change it, and the same thing happens again. Well, someday I'll get it. So look at these rectangles. And if you were going to pick a rectangle that was your ideal rectangle, okay, which one would it be? The most aesthetically pleasing rectangle. Would you pick this first one? How about the second one? How about the third one? Actually, what we should do, if you're going to pick the first one, raise your hand. Okay, there's always a few. I mean, hopefully there is. The second one, a lot. The third one, and the fourth one. Good. I'm glad that someone voted for all of them, because it shows some variety. But a lot of us picked number two, didn't we? What if we took the longer side of each rectangle and and divided it by the shorter side? What was the golden mean? 1.618. So most of us voted for the second one. When you take the longer side and divide it by the shorter side, you get something that's very close to this golden mean, sometimes called phi. And surprising, we like this for some reason. Now, when it's in a rectangle shape, it's called the golden rectangle. At least I didn't say golden triangle in this one. Golden rectangle. And if you had one that was exactly in the proportion of the golden ratio, the one side would be 1.618, and the other side would be 1. It looks like this. Now, inside the golden rectangle, we can draw something that's called the golden spiral. If you like math kind of things, if you make a square, like this first one, and over in this corner on the bottom, you put a piece of string, and you have a pencil, and you go to the other corner over here. I'm going to have to move it down a little bit so I can reach. And then with that string, draw an arc to the top. You get that part of a line. And then you make a smaller square. And do the same thing from the top corner down. And then a smaller square, smaller square, smaller square, and keep doing that. You get this shape. It's called a golden spiral, for those that like math, it's also called a logarithmic spiral, but it's referred to as the golden spiral because it uses phi, this 1.618, the golden ratio, as its basis. And do we see this in nature? Yeah, seashells. This is a conch shell. We do see this in nature. Here's a nautilus shell, and the image on the right is a cross section. You can see the chambers where the little organism grows and lives in, kind of thing. It's in that shape. We also see it in snails, snail shells. Oops, that was right the first time. And different kinds of snail shells. We start to see this golden spiral. In ourselves, the cochlea, part of the inner ear, how we hear, it's in the shape of this golden spiral. Now, I talked about this golden ratio, math symbol phi. There's another one that sometimes, the capital letter phi, that's 0.618. We got the top one by taking a Fibonacci and dividing it by the one that comes before it. 5 divided by 3, 89 divided by 55. Well, what if you divided it the other way and took the 3, divided it by the one that came after it, the 5? The 55 divided by 89. Do that same process, and you get this same phi that is 0.618. Really interesting that it has that kind of order. The difference is only one between the two. So we're going to see a video here shortly, and it uses the 1.618 or the 0.618 as phi, the golden ratio. And this will show some of things in nature that we can see beyond what we've already talked about. So we can start that.
The logarithmic spiral depicts growth and expansion in the universe. For example, if we look at the branching tendencies of a tree, we see that as time progresses, one spiral expands as the number of branches increases. And another spiral contracts as the circumference of branches decreases.
The idealized depiction of the stock market's progress can be seen as a spiral. The top of each successive wave of one higher degree serves as a touch point for the exponential expansion. And pretty soon, it begins to look like the pattern of a hurricane or galaxy.
If you look at the Elliott wave patterns, these patterns involve a certain number of waves called impulse waves and corrective waves. Each type of wave, when broken down into its components, reproduces the Fibonacci sequence as the degrees of subdivision increase. For example, the Fibonacci sequence is in flowerhead arrangements. In this example, notice how from stem to tip, it subdivides 1, 2, 3, and 5. In the human body, we find a Fibonacci branching pattern as well. 5 appendages encompassing legs, arms, and head. 3 subdivisions within the arms and legs. 5 subdivisions off the hands and feet, and 3 subdivisions in the fingers and toes.
The first example of the golden ratio in the average human body is that when the distance between the navel and the foot is taken as one unit, the height of a human being is equivalent to 1.618. Some other golden proportions in the average human body are... the distance between the fingertip and the elbow, the distance between the wrist and the elbow. The distance between the shoulder line and the top of the head. The distance between the navel and the top of the head. The distance between the shoulder line and the top of the head. The distance between the navel and knee. The distance between the knee and the end of the foot. The total width of the two front teeth in the upper jaw over their height gives a golden ratio. The width of the first tooth from the center to the second tooth also yields a golden ratio. The length of face over the width of face. The distance between the lips and where the eyebrows meet over the length of nose. The length of face over the distance between tip of jaw and where the eyebrows meet. The length of mouth over the width of nose. The distance between pupils over the distance between eyebrows. Of the network of the bronchi that constitutes the lung is that it is asymmetric. For example, the windpipe divides into two main bronchi, one long on the left and the other short on the right. This asymmetrical division continues into the subsequent subdivisions of the bronchi. it was determined that in all these divisions, the proportion of the short bronchus to the long was always 1 over 1.618.
The DNA molecule, the code for life, is made up of two intertwining spirals. We find the 0.618 ratio between the helix's width and cycle length.
Surprising, isn't it? The rectangles. Maybe we like this because we see this subconsciously all the time. When your friend smiles at you, you see it in their teeth. When you look at someone, you see it. Now, the pictures they were showing were pretty much all of from the idealized person. Well, you know, my face is rounder than that. So my ratio may be slightly different, but it'll be close. And it's something that we see, even as small as our DNA. Surprising. Does this begin to show God's eternal qualities, his intelligence? Now, if we see it as small as our DNA, we see in pine cones, pineapples, what about on the bigger end of things? Can we see the golden ratio bigger? Yeah, you may have to get off the slide for me. There we go. There we go. Thank you. Yeah, can you see the golden spiral in tropical storms, on hurricanes? Yeah, we have that same kind of shape coming in. And they didn't really point it out when I first showed you the golden spiral. You know, when it wrapped around, it looked like it was going to one center spot, right? Well, it kind of does as it gets smaller and smaller. And that'd be like the eye of the hurricane where it's doing that. And we see it even bigger. This is the Whirlpool Galaxy. Just to kind of refresh your memory, Earth is a planet, we're in our own solar system. We are part of a galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy, and the Milky Way galaxy is one of millions and millions of galaxies in the whole universe. So this is like the largest structure that we look at besides the whole universe itself. So it gets as big as looking at galaxies where there's tens of thousands and millions of stars. This is the Whirlpool Galaxy. And you can see that particular golden spiral. This is another one as well. And this one is actually called the Spiral Galaxy. And we look at that. Well, you know, I mentioned our own Milky Way galaxy. Well, this is an artist rendition of our own Milky Way galaxy. Obviously, we can't get a picture. We can't get a selfie. Had to have really long arms to do that kind of thing. But our galaxy is also a spiral galaxy. And when you look at all of the comet or all the types of galaxies that we've been able to see so far, 77% of them are spiral galaxies. So we see, is this God's fingerprint? We see it as small as our DNA and as large as most of the galaxies out there. Did God create this? Did God create all of this? Really makes you think so, doesn't it? Now, it's sometimes referred to as God's signature, yeah, Christian theologians at least, not the secular ones. But I believe that this is God trying to reveal himself to us in ways that's not directly coming down and forcing us to believe. You can show this to an atheist who wants to be an atheist, and they'll say, forget it. It's you just want to see it. Well, they don't want to see it as well. God really did make our world wonders. And as you study it, you start to see more and more things like this, that you start to say, there had to be a creator. There had to be a designer out there. So let's pray. Father, we thank you that you made nature and all of creation to glorify you. And we want to glorify you this morning, understanding a little bit more about how you did it. And how wondrous you are that you could use this kind of repetition in so many different things. You as science learns more and more, we realize how complex you are and how intelligent you are. There's just so much out there that we can't even begin to understand how you did. And we want to praise you for it. You are the God. You are our creator and the creator of our universe. In Jesus' name.
We're going to sing one more song to close, so let's stand together and sing Forever Rain.
You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. You are peace, when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And no, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. You are more than my words will ever say. Of your
sing no other name. Jesus, Jesus.
Amen. Go in his power this week.